the Iowa caucus is going to break up for a moment here. And Mr. Secretary, thank you for being here. I'll officially welcome you here. Chuck, thank you. Today, the Senate's holding the first hearing in a decade on the need for a path to citizenship for our nation's immigrant farm workers. I am happy to make this not only a full committee hearing, but to acknowledge the chairman of our immigration subcommittee, Alex Padilla, who is an integral part of this conversation and a part of this hearing. During today's hearing, the committee will hear from a wide variety of Americans who support legalizing immigrant farm workers, including farmers, farm worker advocates, and our Secretary of Agriculture, Tom Vilsack. Secretary Vilsack, did you know that this is the first time the Secretary of Agriculture has testified before the Judiciary Committee in more than 20 years? I don't know what that secretary said, but we're glad to have you here today, and thanks for your historic appearance. Now, I have a little video that precedes this, and I'd like to ask that it be shown. It really reflects the reality of the work our immigrant farm workers do to keep our food on the table.
My name is Arely Arteaga, and I am proud to be a part of a family whose labor feeds this nation. No matter rain, wind, hail, they are out there producing our food for us.
You are on the hot ground without shade for hours and moving down the rows with your hands and knees.
If you had watermelon on the 4th of July, you can thank Samuel, Mario, and Juan, who were hard at work in 105-degree weather.
Farm workers face tough conditions even in good times, but during the pandemic, they were deemed essential and kept working, even though many lack the basic safety net they'd need if they got sick.
People who literally keep the country fed.
We've had farmers that I know take their own lives. A lot of farmers with really high stress.
The truth is you leave with fear that you could make your children, your family sick.
If you think about it, about the virus as a wildfire, we are dry tinder.
Some workers are trying to cope with illness and economic hardship even while fearing deportation.
Shea's workers from Mexico were stuck at the border. That one day cost him and his family their entire asparagus profit for the year.
Understand the ramifications of what's going on at the border and the lack of labor that we have in this country.
If our work is essential, would my parents and others be protected from detention and deportation?
Yeah, when we think about those frontline defenders, remember that the farm workers are part of that group. In fact, you might say that they are the base of the safety net.
They're picking the food that's on your dinner table.
Wherever I go, I see the people eating the food that we have harvested and drinking the milk my father has helped produce.
My parents and I have not stopped working in the fields despite during deportation.
Agriculture in general just deserves immigration reform.
Long-term labor solutions that support the health of American agriculture and its workers.
The food supply depends on these workers.
During this pandemic, we've all been forced to face the reality that our food supply chain depends to a great extent on the labor of immigrants. At every step of the food production process, from the moment a crop is planted to the moment our grocery bags are handed to us, there's an immigrant worker who plays a critical role in feeding our families. Their work is essential, and it's never easy. Our nation's farms, factories, and food processing plants can also be dangerous. I know a bit about that, probably more than some senators. Back when I was working my way through college a few years ago, I worked for a meatpacking company in my hometown of East St. Louis, Illinois, Hunter Packing Company, now owned by John Morrell. I was paid $3.65 an hour, which was a pretty good rate. I stood elbow to elbow with the other workers on the assembly line as thousands of pounds of meat came marching nonstop down the conveyor belt. As summer helped for 4 years, I came to work the worst jobs in the packing house. Under our union contract, an 8-hour workday meant processing 1,760 hogs, 220 an hour. Speeding up the overhead chain line meant building up numbers in the case of regular breakdowns. The work was hot, exhausting, dirty, and dangerous. In my home state of Illinois, the jobs at these meat and poultry processing plants are still exhausting, dirty, and dangerous. The next time you put a pork loin on the grill or chicken tenders in your kids' hands, just remember, our foreign-born workforce had a lot to do with the fact that you have that opportunity. And in the decades since I left the assembly line, food processing continues to be difficult and dangerous, especially because of COVID-19. Over the past year, the workers who kept our grocery store shelves stocked have endured immense hardship. The pandemic has torn through our nation's factories as well as our farms, because in these workplaces, social distancing is not an option. Whether they're packing meat or picking berries, the workers who supply our food tend to work in confined and crowded spaces. Many have been unable to protect themselves from exposure to the coronavirus. According to the Environmental Working Group, farm workers in more than a dozen states do not have access to PPE or COVID testing. And it's not uncommon for these workers to be transported to fields in tightly packed trucks housed in closed quarters. All of these factors have led to a devastating outcome. More than 500,000 ag workers have contracted COVID-19. And during the first year of the pandemic, more than 7,000 farm workers died of COVID-19. Sadly, the coronavirus is just one of many workplace hazards these workers face. They handle dangerous machinery. They experience repetitive strain injuries. They're regularly exposed to pesticides. And now we see in our western states, they face sweltering heat. In fact, farm workers are 35 times more likely than the average worker to die from heat exposure. These workers understand the risks of working on a farm. Many of them face another risk, one that is a direct result of our broken immigration system, the threat of deportation. About half of our nation's 2.5 million farm workers are undocumented. These workers head out to the field every morning to pick the fruits and vegetables that feed our families. But despite this essential work, they are at risk of being separated from their families. One of these workers was on the video. Vicente Reyes is a DACA recipient who is currently studying robotics engineering at Bakersfield College in California. Outside of class, he works on a farm in the Central Valley, and he's a member of the United Farm Workers. Vicente is also the son of farm workers. His parents are undocumented. Each morning before they head to the field, there's one brief moment. They're facing a 14-hour shift many times. The parents hug Vicente tight because they never know if it's the last day they'll be together. When the pandemic began, Vicente and his family were unable to shelter in place because they are designated essential critical infrastructure workers by the previous administration. Even though they make essential contributions to our country and our economy, Vicente's parents still live every day in fear of deportation. It is an embarrassment to this great nation that we allow this injustice to continue. We in the Senate can change it. We can pass legislation that will not only keep hardworking families like Vicente's together, but strengthen the durability and resiliency of our food chain. Earlier this year, the House passed the Farm Workforce Modernization Act on a bipartisan basis. This landmark legislation is the product of an historic agreement between farmers and farm workers. It would fundamentally change the lives of hundreds of thousands of farm workers who came to our rescue during the darkest days of the pandemic, and it would allow them to continue doing their essential work without fear of deportation. Many agriculture stakeholders, from dairy to specialty crops to livestock, have said they are facing serious worker shortages and that immigrant farm workers are critical. That's why across America, both farm workers and farmers are calling on the Senate to pass the Farm Workforce Modernization Act. Farm workers not only deserve a path to legal status, they are vital to our nation's economic future. For evidence of that, I look no further than my own state. A few years ago, a legislator from my home state said, quote, "Illinois has been a mirror of America. There is no state, I might add, that better reflects the diversified nature of America's economy. We have one of the largest metropolitan areas around Chicago, and 27 million acres of farmland. And over the past couple decades, a troubling trend has emerged in our state. While the population growth rate in our urban areas has increased, it has decreased in our rural areas. To put it simply, declining population growth means that in years to come, our rural communities are going to have fewer consumers to shop and fewer taxpayers to fund schools and hospitals. And these divergent trends in urban and rural population are not exclusive to my state. They pose a long-term risk to our nation's health. But the Senate can help turn the tide. We can enact reforms to immigration system that encourage families to move to the rural parts of our state, not only so they can work on the farms, but so they can open businesses, restaurants, and shops, and contribute to the economy as consumers and taxpayers. Our farms and the communities surrounding them are some of our nation's greatest assets. Let's enact policies that help them to survive and thrive. When we debate legislation like the Farm Workforce Modernization Act, what we're really debating is the future of America, and particularly rural America. Let's invest in that future with hardworking, good people. With that, I'm going to hand off to Ranking Member Grassley for his opening statement.